In 1898, after 30 years of civil war that exterminated 25% of the Cuban population, and the backbone of the Spanish army was totally broken, the Americans entered the conflict, and there was a Treaty of Paris signed. The Spanish left in 1898, and the Americans stayed there for another 4 years. In 1902, they left always with amendments. They love amend things, saying that they can do whatever they want afterwards. That was the time when the Guantanamo base was installed. For some people, that they don't understand why an American base in Cuba. 1898, 1902. And so this process of plantation agriculture that started after 1810 was totally accentuated in the form that citrus, sugarcane, coffee, and tobacco occupied almost most of the land, and the production of food was totally marginal. And most of the food was brought mainly from the States in this period. That is exactly 1902, May the 20th, to December 31st, 1958. But round figures here. Just call your attention to that. 85% of the total arable land of the island. But of that 85%, 90% were in the hands of 20 American companies and 10 Cuban families. We were not a country of farmers. Only small pockets were there. And of course, it was proverbial, like the misery in the Cuban countryside. We have to say this, and this is important. They have enough land not to apply the so-called conventional or green revolution agriculture between 1945 and 1959 because they have so much land that they can do in a more friendly way. So before the revolution, there was not very, very little. In Cuba, there were 1,300 tractors or something like that. And of course, migrating groups, people that came from Spain after the civil war there. People from Haiti and Jamaica that they were cheap labor to cut the sugarcane in Cuba by hand. Who needs a tractor when you can employ people and you can pay with token money, not even real money? And they can only spend that money on the shop of the owner of the sugar mill. So the situation in Cuba by the end of the first half of the 20th century was totally desperate. Even when the big cities look beautiful and there were lots of casinos and brothels and things like that. So in the floor, you will have like a totally black island, no? 95-97% covered by forest. Before the big expansion of the agriculture, the sugarcane agriculture, only 20% of the forests were clear. When the Spanish left, there's still more than half of the native ecosystems were there. But this is what we inherited in 1959. 14% of forests left. The destruction of 86% of climate forests and native ecosystems. The whole country totally devastated and based in this plantation agriculture. In many places, they knew that the conventional agriculture won't last for long. But they did it because of the high prices of the post-war economy. After the World War II, when sugar was like a one strategic crop. This is what happened. The big challenge for the revolution was to change the situation on the Cuban fields. And so the first thing was try to do a big literacy campaign in 1961 to create minimal infrastructure for farmers, to give them land. 200,000 families received land in Cuba. The biggest size of private farm in Cuba was reduced to 27 hectares. But all of that, they were bringing It was brought always the big problem with the states. First, they refused to buy the Cuban sugar. Second, they refused to keep selling us petrol. The American companies refused to refine Russian petrol. And then they did that embargo. We almost died in the missile crisis in 1962, the whole war. And there was no other choice. We were technically pushed to be part of the economic block of the former socialist countries of Eastern Europe. Then our trend of development was very similar like Australia. We were using those 10 trucks, combined tractors, 10 tons, to cut the sugar cane. The population went to the cities. The degradation of land was terrible. The good things were several, no? That we were producing that produce and sending to Europe, and they cannot produce it there because they were cold countries. In exchange, they sell most of the food. We're importing more than 70% of the food we eat. In some cases, like vegetable oils and lard, it was almost 90%. And at the same time, they were sending lots of petrol, 30 million tons, 1989, because this tractor makes 2 kilometers on the liter of diesel. They're very... And nevertheless, it was possible for Cubans to achieve a dignified livelihood that was not achieved in any country of Latin America in that time, and not even after, with the neoliberal governments that happens in Latin America after that. And we have to say, it was something fair trade, no? Like they were paying us more money than the world market, and they were selling the material cheaper, and we were part of it. And so we were, in some point, destroying a part of our natural resources, but it was the trend that the whole world, that was so-called development, progress, the future. And we had to do it. To give you some idea of the land degradation facts, the agricultural surface in the countries, there are millions of hectares. And this is the result. 60% of the country is affected by land degradation and process that can lead to desertification. Desertification is the deterioration of the soil capacities, not like the whole place will become a desert. So you can have land totally degraded, and you can have a rainfall like Cuba, 1,500 millimeters, okay? So nothing can grow there because the soil is sand. It's totally damaged. Of course, that's a lot of water for you, for Australia. That's a lot of water per inhabitant per year. But this is internationally considered a hydrical stress situation. So right now, we recognize two of the five environmental problems in Cuba are land degradation and lack of water. Why not deforestation? I will explain to you later. Just to give you some numbers, and this was Cuba by that time. This is a Lada, this is a Moscovich, this is a military Russian equipment. This is the famous camel, El Camello, 250 people there. This is a cocoa taxi, it's moved by gas, rickshaw. Without time, without warning, we lost everything. All the life support systems were totally endangered. Our purchase capacity of food fell in 60%. The sugar price was 5 cents for a pound. And so it was expensive to produce the sugar than to sell it. Very sad.